There he goes.
There we go.
Are you good?
We're good.
All right. Good evening, everyone. I'd like to call to order Independence School District 624. Would the clerk please read the roll?
Chapman.
Here.
Ellison, here. Mullen.
Here.
Newmaster.
Here.
Thompson.
Here.
Arcand.
Here.
Beloid.
Here.
All right. Thank you all very much. With that, it's now time for the Pledge of Allegiance. Would ask us to please stand and join us in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag
of the United States
of America and to the Republic
which it stands,
one nation.
Under God,
indivisible, with
liberty and justice for all.
All right. Thank you very much. On tonight's agenda before us, we have the approval of the agenda for tonight, for this evening. Is there a motion to approve the agenda for this evening?
So moved.
There's been a motion by Mr. Chapman. Is there a second?
Second, Marge.
Second by Dr. Newmaster. This will require a roll call vote. Would ask the clerk to please read the roll.
Chapman.
Aye.
Ellison, aye. Mullen.
Aye.
Newmaster.
Aye.
Thompson.
Aye.
Arcand.
Aye.
Lloyd.
Aye.
Thank you very much. We have an agenda. We also have before us a consent agenda. And these are the sundry items that typically take place at our school board meeting. And the one thing that I am so grateful for is the generosity of the community towards the district. With that, I would ask for a motion to please approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
A motion by Ms. Thompson. Is there a second?
Second, Arcand.
A second by Dr. Arcand. This also will require a roll call vote and would ask the clerk to please read the roll.
Chapman.
Aye.
Ellison, aye. Mullen.
Aye.
Newmaster.
Aye.
Thompson.
Aye.
Arcand.
Aye.
Lloyd.
Aye.
All right. Thank you all very much. We have our consent agenda. It is now time for our meeting for public forum. This will be a forum that allows the public to discuss anything on the agenda of the school board. And we would ask that anybody wishing to speak keep their comments to 3 minutes or less, and that no more than three people can speak on the same subject. Dr. Kazmacek, being that we are virtual, is there any comments for the public forum?
I believe there's at least one. So, Ms. Betty, will you take it from here?
Yes, I will. We've received one public comment entry from Michael McKenzie. And the public comment is, there has understandably been a push to get students back in school. Every teacher and parent I know wants this to happen as soon as it can be done safely. Nobody thinks distance learning is ideal. At best, it's been a necessary evil. However, what non-teachers do not fully understand is just how much work goes into preparing for multiple possible scenarios. 5-period every other day classes, 3-period every 4-week classes, design changes mid-quarter, design changes mid-semester, design learning, distance learning for all students, distance learning for any student who wants to opt for that choice. The options are limited only by the number of options on which is best for the students, teachers, and staff involved. I'm here to beg you to make the decision as best you can, tell us as soon as possible, and stick to it regardless of public pushback. The decision starts, stops, and changes we've put up with this year have been terribly draining and a waste of time. I would humbly suggest that if we decide based on probability and not wishful thinking, we'd agree to the following. Number one, the experts are in general agreement that the next 4 to 7 weeks we'll see continued case and death increases. Number two, it will take at least 3 to 4 months to get a critical mass of people vaccinated. Number three, that means right now we should take third quarter and announce it as full distance learning. Number four, we should also set a date certain for deciding about quarter four. I would pick the March 22nd, 20, 2021 school board meeting to decide. That should allow us to see what the vaccine distribution is like, the case and death incidents, and allow us 3 weeks to adjust curriculum. Thank you. Good luck with your decision. Please know that you are appreciated. And that's it.
Thank you very much, Ms. Vetti. Dr. Kazmierczak, is there anybody in the district center that would wish to address the school board?
There's nobody here.
Okay, thank you very much. We will now move on to our first informational item, C1, which is the superintendent's report. Dr. Kazmierczak.
All right, thank you, Chair Mullen and members of the board. The district was recently recognized in the Press Publications Reader's Choice Local section. The district's website won Best Website, and we just received the certificate right here today. It should also be mentioned that White Bear Lake Area High School teacher Wendy Suya was named as a finalist in the Best Teacher category. Thank you, Press Publications Readers, for these honors. The White Bear Lake Area Educators Local number 7286 will be seeking nominations for Teacher of the Year in a nomination process that will open soon. Please consider nominating an educator who will represent all of the dedicated teachers in our district and compete in the state level program. Find the form online at isd624.org on December 21st. Nominations will be open until 4 p.m. on Monday, January 11th. We hope that students and staff members enjoy themselves during the upcoming winter break. School will not be in session from December 23rd through January 3rd. We look forward to welcoming students and families back to start 2021 off right on Monday, January 4th. We are also excited to offer virtual welcome events for next year's students for Welcome to White Bear activities happening in January. Information and registration virtual events will be hosted at all levels, including early childhood, elementary, middle school, and high school. Information about these events will soon be available on the school and district websites. Community members will have time to chat with me over a cup of coffee between 11:30 a.m. and 12:30 p.m. on Thursday, January 7th for the quarterly Coffee with Dr. K check-in. There is no set agenda, so please feel free to grab a coffee and join the virtual conversation, which we'll pull off on live stream with questions submitted through an online form. Details will be available on the district website the week of the event. Principals, board liaisons, district leaders, and construction partners recently gathered to celebrate groundbreaking at construction sites currently underway throughout the district. The projects include an additional gymnasium at the current South Campus, additions at Lincoln, Matoska International, Badness Heights, and Willow Lane Elementaries, and a brand new transportation building. Find additional facilities information on the building or future page of the website. At this point, I'll hand it over to Mr. Wald.
Thank you, Dr. Kazmierczak. The Minnesota Association of School Administrators, MASA, has named Dr. Kazmierczak the 2021 Minnesota Superintendent of the Year. As the Minnesota honoree, Dr. K is a candidate among other state recipients for National Superintendent of the Year to be announced during the American Association of School Administrators National Conference on Education hosted virtually on February 18th and 19th of 2021. Dr. Kazmierczak was selected for this honor by a panel of representatives from a variety of Minnesota education organizations. Nominees are evaluated on how each candidate demonstrates leadership for learning, communication skills, professionalism, and community involvement. Dr. K is an excellent representative of public education in Minnesota and will represent White Bear Lake and the MASA well. Congratulations, Dr. Kazmierczak.
All right, thank you, point, Mr. Wall.
I'll hand it over to our student report, Ms. Jennifer Adams.
Good evening, everyone. So this week, students are still distance learning, and they're trying their hardest to stay motivated and on task. Let's be sure that we utilize our counselors and graduate on time, along with the support hub and Bear Care Wellness, which can be found on the school's website. As the holidays approach, let's remember to wear a mask and keep our loved ones safe. not sure who this was applied to. I'm sorry.
That's right, Ms. Adams. Thank you very much. I'll take it. Dr. Kazmichek, okay. Is there anything else that...
There is, yep.
Okay.
So I will resume. All right. So it's a brief COVID-19 update. So this is a reminder that we continue to keep our COVID-19 dashboard updated during distance learning, but the data represent only those students and staff members who are learning or working on site due to participation in tier one or special population learning experiences. That said, it is important for families to continue to report COVID-19 cases to us, even when their student is home in distance learning. We are working to track the impact COVID-19 has had on our student and staff community, which will be data to be considered as we discuss the possibility of returning to less restrictive learning models in the future. When we return from winter break on January 4th, our students will continue in the distance learning model. In early January, we will reevaluate the learning model based on guidance from the Minnesota Department of Health and the Minnesota Department of Education, as well as our local data. So at that, I want to pause at this point, and board members, if you have any specific questions at this time regarding learning model or where we're at. And then I have one more item after this.
Thank you, Dr. K. Is there any questions for Dr. Kazmichek?
Chair Mullen, this is...
Go ahead, Ms. Ellison.
Sorry, wasn't sure which... thing to use. Dr. Kazmichek, do you have any sense of whether or not Governor Walz or the Minnesota Department of Education are planning to make any sort of announcements? I know he's making an announcement Wednesday regarding the shutdowns across the state. Do you have any sense if that will include schools?
I have a sense it'll include youth activities, youth sports, state high school league sponsored activities. But I have not heard any indication that it'll involve learning models for schools for the school year.
And then a follow-up question to that, do you have a sense if MDE and MDH are going to be reevaluating their parameters?
Mm-hmm. There have been a lot of requests for them to do that. There have been different superintendent groups have asked that they evaluate the standards that were established back in July. I know there was an article yesterday in the Star Tribune that talked, Department of Health official talked about from their perspective that those parameters seem to be working quite well, and so they might not change, but on the other hand, they could change. And so I think by the time early January rolls around, if there are going to be adjustments to those criteria, I think we would know that by then. So I think the timing for our conversation and consideration will work well with that. If they don't make any changes, with the county case rates anticipated to be high for the foreseeable future, it's unlikely that we would see a change anytime soon. And I'm going to be reluctant to put out a date certain in the future because I don't think that makes a lot of sense because we don't know exactly how the case rates will continue to evolve either up or down in the next few weeks. So giving it a little more time will allow the data to, again, be, you know, we'll work with the data that's current at the time and whether or not the Department of Health makes modifications to the criteria, we would have a better sense for that in 3 or 4 weeks.
Great, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Other questions, comments, concerns? All right, Dr. Kazmichek, okay.
I have one more thing. So last but not least, I want to say a special thank you to Jody Reber, who is retiring next week after 32 years in the district. She has seen a lot of exciting changes since she began in 1988, which coincidentally is the year I graduated from high school. She's worked with three superintendents over that time. She's been in the superintendent's office for 27 years, and she's worked with three superintendents. And she's worked with a multitude of board members during the time. I did a quick calculation. She probably has attended and prepared for over 600 school board meetings. So thank you, Jody, for your service and for keeping us going all these years. Enjoy retirement. And that's all I have.
Thank you, Dr. Kazmichek. And thank you, Jody. And congratulations to you, Dr. Kazmichek, on the superintendent. Well deserved. Thank you very much for your work.
Thank you, Mr. Mullen.
So with that, if there's any questions, any comments, we will move into our discussion items. Discussion item D1 is needs to start at 7 o'clock. It's the truth and taxation hearing. So what we'll do is we'll skip by that currently and we'll come back to it at 7 o'clock, kind of wherever we're at in the board meeting. With that, we will move into D2, which is the 2021 and 22 school year calendar. Dr. Gillespie, thanks.
Thank you, Chair Mullen, members of the board, Dr. Kazmichek. Before you is a recommendation for the 21-22 calendar. Last year, you set a majority of the major dates in terms of the start and end of the school year and the major school breaks. This calendar adds non-student days, which would include professional development and teacher work days. And then it adds the quarter dates for our families and students in terms of first, second, third, and fourth quarter. I would like to thank a stakeholder group that I worked with. This is my first calendar in my new role, and I really appreciated the dialogue around strengths and opportunities for us as we look at this calendar and calendars in the future. We will have a committee, two committees work on professional development and then parent-teacher conferences. We've learned a lot this year and had some successes that people are excited about. And so what can we do to make professional development continue to be relevant for our educators and staff members? And then we learned a lot around parent-teacher conferences this year and received quite a bit of positive feedback around options for virtual conferences and are curious as to what that might look like in the future. And so we'll continue to work on that over the next couple of months. And so this is the calendar that's before you for our next school year.
So my understanding is that I do not see it on the agenda. So is this coming back before us next month?
It is, absolutely. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any questions or comments regarding the 2020-2021 calendar that will come back before us next month? Okay. Hearing or seeing none, we will move on to our next discussion item, which is D3, the middle school programming. Is this you, Dr. Gillespie?
It is, yep. So, Chair Mullen, members of the board, Dr. Kazmichek, I'd like to introduce Jen Babish, Director of Curriculum and Instruction, along with our middle school principals, Christina Pierre and Catherine Peterson, here to talk about middle school programming.
Good evening, Chair Mullen, members of the board, and Dr. Kazmichek. I'm here tonight with my fellow middle school principals and a few middle school language arts teachers to give you an update on middle school programming. You can go ahead and advance the slide. So over the past 2 years, we worked on our middle school programming to include more literacy, more specifically reading and writing for students in grades 6th and 7th grade, and align our language arts programming to the middle school buildings and the district's strategic plans. We work collaboratively with the world's best workforce, parent groups, our language arts teachers, and continue to analyze our reading data. Tonight, we are here to give you an update on literacy and to recommend enriched language arts for all of our students. I will now hand it off to middle school principal, Catherine Peterson.
You can advance the slide. And so this slide is just to bring us back as a reminder where we were prioritizing literacy when we were making some changes last year, that the changes that we made were really grounded in the research and focused really on a gradual release with a demonstration where teachers would provide some demonstration to students. They have supported practice in the classroom. And then it's really focused on that ongoing assessment so that each student is getting exactly what he or she needs. What we really like about this is that it really does empower students so that they are not only setting goals, but they're in a constant state of self-assessment and reflection. There's a focus on conversation with the teachers to include some conferencing. And then they're able to apply and transfer skills in multiple texts so that students are able to read a text that is a just right fit for them. And then we're able to differentiate for the students in that way. In addition, it allows students to be able to engage in that academic discourse, regardless of the book that they're reading. They're able to come together around ideas, whether they're discussing theme or character traits, things like that. They can talk about that within different books. You can advance the slide. The other piece that we thought was really important for middle school, and we're thinking about the middle school programming, is to remember that there is a continuum, that when students start in kindergarten, we're really focused on teaching them how to read. And as they progress through their senior year, it is more focused on reading in order to learn. In the middle, we're right in the middle. We still have some kids who need that intentional support with learning how to read, but there's a greater focus on being able to read in order to learn. And so our changes addressed students to be able to meet them where they're at with the specific skills that they need. With that, I'm gonna turn it over to Christina Pierre.
All right, please advance the slide. Good evening, everyone. So here's where we are now. The change that we've implemented this year is for all sixth and seventh graders, in addition to the full year of language arts, where we're focusing on reading to learn, all sixth and seventh graders also have a literacy class, which is a half year class. And in that class, we're focusing on the writing composition aspect. So they're getting basically a year and a half of language arts and literacy. Next slide, please. We're going to have a few of our language arts teachers from the middle schools talk about what that looks like. Amber, would you like to go first?
Sure, I can go. So I teach at Central Middle School, and right now I have three sections of language arts and two sections of literacy. And I find it really beneficial that we kind of divide it up between reading and writing. I've noticed this year the writing with my students has really increased. They're writing a lot more. They get to choose what to write about, but then they also have a topic that they have to write about. So right now we're doing personal narratives. I have some students that are working just off a graphic organizer and using sentence starters, and I have other students that are writing above and beyond and adding in dialogue and including everything that they need to with figurative language to make their stories really take off. It's been nice to see some of those students that need that really in-depth graphic organizer and the sentence starters go from needing sentence starters in the first paragraph to the second paragraph, kind of trying to do it on their own. That's been really nice to see. Able to conference with the students has helped a lot. So taking time now that we're digital, like in breakout rooms, able to sit and talk with the students and go through their work, I think they've really gained a lot from that.
Thanks, Amber.
Yep.
Katie Knorr is next.
Sure. Hi. Good evening, everyone. My name is Katie Knorr, and I teach language arts at Central. I echo what Amber has said. I think just the second touch point of literacy is really important, especially those writing components. Having taught language arts for a long time, I know that the skills in this class cross multiple disciplines, that students are asked to read and write in science class and history class, foreign language class. And I think some of these skills that we're building in this additional kind of class are really, as time goes on, going to help students in every class. They're going to be, it helps them to just to be able to critically think a little bit more and to just another touch point to practice those writing skills is, I think, is a key component. The teachers that have been teaching the class this year have found great success in it. They do enjoy it. Like I said, like Amber said, the kids having some choice in what they write. And it's just been really beneficial. And I can say for my class, currently doing research, again, that self-driven piece where they choose what they look at, they find their own sources. Some of them, I help them, you know what, we guide them, we talk together about what makes a good source, and they're doing that reading piece, but it really builds off of each other. I think that's the big thing, is that the two classes build off each other, and hopefully they learn skills that they can use across every class.
Thanks, Katie. And then Rachel Schmidt.
Hi. Yeah, I agree with everything that everyone just said. I'm seeing that in my classrooms as well. I also think from the language arts perspective, it has been so beneficial to see them get like targeted reading instruction all year long, whereas previously we might have put a pause and sort of like kept doing some reading, but less like new learning and reading while we were doing writing. Language arts was reading and writing. So it's been so good to see kids be able to sort of get targeted reading instruction from their language arts teacher all year and have that keep going. And adding the literacy piece, I mean, I just see kids making that connection so often. Like they will use vocabulary that they developed in their writing to talk about something that they notice in an author's writing. They will use, they will talk about a skill that they notice in an author, something that an author was doing in a book, and there's like, how can I bring that into my own story that I'm writing? And that kind of transfer is really when we see that like they're really cooking mentally, and they're making things happen, because then, you know, that transfer can go to other classes and, you know, bring in all kinds of other ideas as well. So it's been really fun to see that, because it's when that's happening sort of simultaneously that I notice that I've seen it most, as opposed to, oh, remember a month ago when we talked about this in language arts class. So that's been really, really great.
Thanks, Rachel. So school board members, in case you weren't picking up on the enthusiasm, we are really excited about this change, and we're very thankful that we are able to add the additional half year for our sixth and seventh grade students. We're ready for the next slide. So here's our proposal. We'd like to merge two classes, our language arts and our enriched language arts classes. And the reason that we'd like to do that is because they've become redundant. Both classes have the same range of abilities because we have challenge by choice in middle school. And so students of all abilities are choosing both courses or being placed in one course or the other due to what the requirements of their schedule. So again, the classes are redundant. Teachers are already differentiating to the needs of individuals and small groups. And so if we can bring those together into one course, we'll be able to make the schedule work better for all students, especially for students who have really specialized schedules. So that might be students who have an advanced course or a special music class like band or orchestra or choir, or students with special needs, English learners. All of them, we don't have as many sections of those courses. And so by bringing together the language arts and enriched language arts, we're able to make the schedule more flexible for all of those students. And then finally, having one language arts course will make our language arts department even that much more powerful, because all those teachers will be able to collaborate together. Next slide, please. And on top of it all, we will continue to offer a wide range of enrichment opportunities for students in the area of literacy. Here are some examples: school newspaper, yearbook, and after-school book clubs. I think that's all our slides.
So in January, we'll bring a recommendation that you would approve our proposal. So we are here tonight with our teacher leaders to answer any questions that you might have for this proposal.
Any questions regarding the proposal?
Chair Mullen, I have a question. It's Deb.
And I do
too. Ms. Beloit.
Yeah, I was just wondering, I understand combining the enriched with the regular. My question is about, is there differential grading between, as we have it right now, between, you know, a regular literature class and an enriched class, or is it all just based on the standards for that grade? And follow up to that is, how would that change if it's all combined and we're differentiating between kids within the same class?
Yep, so I can take that, and the principals feel free to chime in. But it is the same standards in both classes, and so there wouldn't be any changes of looking at the standards, and then also the same grading as well.
So then what was the reason for having the enriched classes to begin with? Because we've been differentiating for quite a few years now. I see everyone nodding, so I guess I've come to the table late for discussion, I guess, but it's always been a question for me.
Yeah, I think it's all dated, Deb. It's a good question, but it's really run its course.
Can I ask a question? This is Marge.
Don, you're muted. Termullen, you're muted.
Thank you. Ms. Beloit, did that answer your question?
I'm sorry, I couldn't, there was so much reverberation going on, I couldn't hear Ms. Pierre.
Ms. Pierre, can you re-answer that question, please, for Ms. Beloit?
Yeah, I stopped talking because of the feedback. And so I apologize for that if that was due to my end. So I agree, Deb, Ms. Beloit, it is outdated. It's an outdated course. We are able to push students just as far within the regular course just by differentiating to individual abilities, which we're already doing. So we are confident that we're able to push students and really challenge them, even our very top students, and we're doing that already.
Well, I just want to say that my younger son and my older son had both of the teachers. Well, my younger son had two of the teachers that are on here tonight, and my older son had at least one of the teachers, and they both did a phenomenal job doing the differentiated teaching with them. So I like combining it and doing that kind of work. So I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Beloit. Dr. Newmaster, did you have a question?
I do. And I agree totally with the approach you're taking. I think other subject areas have done it. And I think that Deb's question about different, like, weighted grades is more of a high school thing when it's a college in the schools or something like that. But when my own kids went through, I didn't think there was any difference in whatever class you took. A grade was a grade. They weren't weighted in middle school. I guess my question was, and I do see that the middle school schedule seems to be kind of slimming down to a more manageable concept with the changes that you're putting in. But I guess what I'm wondering is if the department's taken the step, but I remember North Campus kind of aiming at, and I heard murmurs about South back when I was still teaching, that they were trying to make sure that everyone covered the same material within a specific quarter. So it made it easier when you had a specialized schedule and something changed because you had art and you had to move your section of communications or literacy or whatever. So is middle school also looking at kind of doing something like that where they're actually covering the same material within a, not in the same week, but maybe within the same quarter?
I can answer, and then I guess I would defer to one of the teachers that they could add on. So that is a part of that work with that last bullet point, that when we don't have all of the different courses, both the enriched and the language arts, and we have fewer, it allows us to be able to schedule so that teachers are teaching the same course, easier to schedule potentially for some common prep time and collaboration time for teachers to be able to work together. And I would just give a shout out to the teachers from both departments at Central and Sunrise for the work that I have done with them over the last year, where they have really come together to be collaborative in the work, to say, what is the best order to teach these standards? What is the best way to reach the students? And they've engaged in a lot of dialogue across both buildings so that not only within each building is there some fidelity, like within the courses and really looking at the standards, but having that discourse with each other to be able to improve the courses across the entire middle school. And so I don't know if Rachel or Amber or Katie want to add, but the teachers have really, I have witnessed them being committed to that work.
Yeah, I just to add, I've never, every year I've been here, I've worked here 4 years now, it's gotten better. And the last 2 years, I've never witnessed like this level of collaboration in teachers within the building, also teachers outside. Like every year it gets a little bit better. I know at Sunrise, like we share everything. I mean, every Sunrise literacy class, we're doing the same thing tomorrow. And not having that based in sort of like strict rules or anything, but just because of the level of collaboration has been so, so deep. And I think that when in terms of our cross school collaboration, we are like moving towards that a little step better all the time. And that's certainly, I know we have a lot of really good common goals there and common rapport.
Dr. Newmaster, did I answer your questions? Dr. Newmaster, are you muted still?
Thought I turned it off. Okay. My question kind of builds off your answer, which, you know, shows the collaboration is growing and you've got a good unity in your department. And my question is, as you balance everything, as the magicians that you are, that somehow collaboration doesn't mean lockstep, same choice for everybody. And we're still using the equity lens to have a variety of positive role models so people reflect themselves in their reading. So it's just one more thing to balance, and I'm sure you stir it all in, but I just wanted to make sure everybody didn't read the same thing at the same time, that there's choice and diversity.
Thank you, Dr. Newmaster. Is there any other questions, comments, concerns?
Chair Mullen, I had one more question. This is Deb.
Ms. Blood.
This is actually for Dr. Gillespie. I was wondering if we had looked at this as part of our efforts in equity, because I guess at the middle school level, I looked at a lot of these classes. If they're the same and we're not doing a lot, we have, you know, enrich this, enrich that, and we have certain students that choose one and others that think, oh no, well, I can't do enriched, you know, that's going to be too difficult. And if it's really just the same kind of thing, I think we're setting up a lot of students for thoughts of failure, whether they're failing or not. So I was just wondering if we had looked at that through the equity lens as well, and if that came into the decision for doing it this way, the change. Yeah. Anyway.
Absolutely. Yeah, that is our middle schools and middle school educators and their conversations and the work that they've done over these past years. It has been through that lens of how best to meet the needs of each of our students, but also how do we really deliver on our equity commitment and use the equity decision-making protocol. So, yep, absolutely.
I might add one thing, that conversation about enriched courses has been going on ever since I arrived 7 years ago, and Jen's nodding her head as if it was happening well before that. Too, and I think the equity work that's happened more recently has actually helped us to navigate questions like this more effectively. I would argue.
Thank you, Dr. Kazurchek. Are there any other questions, comments, concerns? Okay, hearing or seeing none. We will, unless Dr. Gillespie, unless you had anything else.
No, I just want to thank our teacher leaders and principals. They're doing a ton of work, and then to also be able to navigate this for the upcoming school year, you're appreciated. So thank you so much. And we'll bring thank it for action next month.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Thank you all for your work. We really appreciate it. With that, we will move into our next discussion item. Which is D4, which is the Guarantee Energy Savings Agreement. Mr. Wald, do you have time for this one and to get us into our 7 o'clock public meeting?
I think we do.
Okay, yep. Then I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Chair Mullen, members of the board, Dr. Kazmierczak and Ms. Adams. A year ago, we brought a proposal to the board to install solar panels at 6 of our sites. By working with a third party, Ideal Energies, we were able to utilize tax incentives for solar installation. As a government agency, we don't pay taxes, so we're not able to access solar tax incentives. So by contracting with a third party, tax incentives are accessible to make the installation of the panels possible for zero investment. As I said, we installed panels on 6 sites last year, and we would have done more, but as these are roof-mounted systems, we only want to put them on new roofs. As we completed roofs at several sites last summer and have new construction in process, we're able to work again with Ideal Energies and access tax incentives again for installation on additional sites. So by doing so, we guarantee energy savings at no cost to the district. At the meeting tonight is Chris Sijos from Ideal Energies, as well as Dan Rozier, our Director of Facilities and Grounds. And I'll turn it over to Dan, who will share some information about how things are going with our current installed panels, as well as describe the work to be completed in the second phase. So, Mr. Rozier.
Thank you. Yeah, as Mr. Wald said, we started working with the school board a little over a year ago on a concept to install solar panels on 6 of our roofs. That happened last summer of 2019. And in the fall of 2019 and early winter, we had all 6 up and running. So we've got about a year's worth of data now. I'll just remind you of the 6 schools that we did last year. It was Onika, Birch Lake, Lake Ayers, Willow, Atoska, and Sunrise. So those 6 buildings all have solar now for about a year. So we've got about a year's worth of data just to see how the solar is doing. And I'm really thrilled that the numbers have been awesome that are coming in. Ideal Energies kind of told us this is what we should expect from our panels. And it's just unbelievable how close the estimates were about the kilowatt hours that they're producing. It came within 99.4% of their estimates of what we produced with our solar. So just to give a brief overview at some of our sites, over at Onika, solar accounted for about 6.5% of the total energy used at the building. Over at Birch Lake, a smaller building, solar produced 16% of the energy that the building used. And over at Lake Ayers, over the course of 13 months, solar produced about 20% of the energy used at the building. So pretty impressive results. And the most impressive thing is the district didn't have to put any money up front to put the panels on the roof. It all came with a guaranteed energy savings. So how we pay for the panels, the incentives are part of it. They go to Ideal Energies for the cost of the panels and the install. And then 80% of the energy produced, we kick back to Ideal Energies. We keep 20% of the savings. And that 20% we keep for the first 13 years on this installation. And then after that 13 years, everything's paid off. We realize all the savings from the panels. So pretty good deal for the district. So we started looking at the data and we decided we had some new roofs this summer. We're building some new buildings. We're going to look at phase 2. And we started working with Ideal Energies a couple months ago to explore some options. So for phase 2, the schools that we're thinking about putting solar on, we're now only going to expand off Willow and Lake Ayers. Right now, the arrays at Willow and Lake Ayers are on the gym roof. The roofs that on the other sections of the buildings are brand new. I think they're 2 years old now. So we're going to look at expanding the 40 kW systems and pretty much tripling the size of the solar that are on those 2 buildings. Some other buildings we're going to look at, District Center and Central. We replaced a large section of roof on District Center and Central this summer. We're exploring the idea of putting solar on that new roof. South Campus, we did a huge roof project over there. We're going to look at putting solar over on that new roof, as well as the new gym that we're building over at South Campus. Lincoln's getting a new gym. We're going to look at putting solar on the Lincoln roof. Bus garage, Chris's team is working with Wold Architects right now to put a solar layout on that roof. And then in the future, the new Hugo Elementary and the new high school addition, we want to put quite a bit of solar on those roofs. So like I said, this has been a big win for us. no money out of our pockets, and we're realizing some pretty substantial savings. So pretty exciting. Just the total number of what our solar produced, it was about 287,000 kilowatt hours at all six buildings. That all put together, I know it's spread out over six buildings, but that's enough energy to power one of our average size elementaries, the Lake Ayers, Birch, Willow, Matoska. That's about how many kilowatt hours we use in a year. So pretty good amount. I didn't think, I was a little skeptical when we started working with Ideal Energies. They promised us a lot. It seemed like a deal, probably too good to be true, but it's really worked out well, and we're excited to expand off of it. And Chris Sios is here. I don't know, Chris, do you have anything to add, or Chris is here for questions also?
Gosh, Dan, I don't know what to say after that. We're just really blessed to work with you guys. We're really grateful that we've earned the stripes well enough to be able to come back and re-explore opportunities with you. Thank you for letting us work with your architects to be prudent about it. Smart. I think we've got things really kind of boiled down to repeat what the success that we've had with the projects we've done so far.
Yeah, and we've had a lot of other school districts in the state contact us and ask us about our solar. So it's really kind of put White Bear Lake schools out in front of things, and it's kind of cool to get them phone calls, and they're excited about White Bear Lake schools, and the city and a lot of surrounding communities are kind of asking about what we've done.
I think one of the important values too is there's certainly energy savings for us, but it reduces our carbon footprint, and that was an important goal for the school district, for our strategic plan to be good world citizens and reduce our reliance on energy systems. So that's been really a great thing as well.
Mr. Wald, is there time for questions?
Sure.
Hey, listen, I'm just going to ask. I appreciate everything that the energy, the solar piece has done. I think it's great for the school district. I'm just wondering, when we had first started working with the company, they had talked about some classroom components being able to, for all of our learners to be able to kind of experience and talk about how the solar program has helped with the not only energy savings, but kind of use it as a teachable moment. I'm just kind of curious if there's any update on how we're utilizing it in the system, in the curriculum with our schools. I understand we've been in distant learning, but has there been any advancement in that area?
Yeah, that we got stung a little bit by the pandemic on that one. And so it was a second semester project that our fifth grade teachers would be working on. And of course, last year, we ended up going distance learning in second semester. And Jen Babish, are you still on the call? Maybe not. Okay. So Jen Babish, our curriculum coordinator, is working with our instructional coaches to lead the fifth grade teachers through the curriculum planning process. So second semester of this year, assuming that we're able to engage the students, we're going to be implementing that curriculum. Thanks to Chris Sios. And Chris, I think, is that Rich over your shoulder there? We can't quite see him. Okay, Rich Raggett. His colleague that we've been working with, they've delivered on the curriculum pieces. We have it in-house, and our curriculum or our instructional coaches are working on that.
I appreciate that. And then just kind of as a follow-up, you know, one of the things that we had talked about was how technology is changing. And I'm just wondering, how has the technology of solar changed? Is everything advances? Are we continuing to adapt and keep up with that? And is it still more, how's the cost effectiveness going with the updated technology?
I'll comment on that one. So what we've done is we're leveraging the newest parts that are available in the marketplace. They're kind of maxed out as far as solar panels go and what will fit on a rooftop system. So we're using panels that are 410 kilowatts, which is the highest density panel you can use from the best manufacturers out there. There are rooms and advancements in solar, but what happens is they tend to be related to ground-mounted installations, which are on the ground where solar technology is evolving, so the underside of a panel that sees light will produce energy too. But that doesn't work when they're sitting on a roof and that's not viable. So that technology doesn't make sense. And then the other thing that's happening is solar panels are getting a little bit physically larger for ground mounts. But what happens is in order to make sure the solar panels and the weight that transfers from the solar panels on your roof as it's held down lands in the right spots, solar panels are kind of ideally sized right now. So they're maxed out from the square footage that can be produced for solar panels. And we're reflecting all the benefits of kind of the modified technology as it comes forward and what we're delivering as we go forward. As an example, since we originally started talking to Tim and Dan about this project, there's been a higher density panel that's available that we've substituted, which is the one that I mentioned that kind of maxes out density for rooftop systems. So we're kind of state of the art in the quality and character of the parts that we're bringing to the district. And I believe that that's one of the reasons why we're seeing the kind of results that we're seeing.
And in addition to that, we haven't had additional opportunities or guaranteed energy savings that we think would be better than the opportunity that we have with Ideal.
All right, perfect. Thank you very much for the update. I really appreciate it. Is there any other questions, comments, concerns? The only thing I want to just keep in mind, and I'll call on you, just I might need to interrupt right in the middle if we're getting into that 7 o'clock time frame. So I just want to make sure I bring that and acknowledge that. So, Mr. Chapman, I've seen that you came off mute. Do you have a question?
Boy, you're good there, Chair Mullen. Yes, I do have a few questions. I noticed, first off, well, let me say that I think this is phenomenal news as far as the usage, the power that's being generated, the kilowatt hours. I did notice in those facilities that do have the installs already on the roofs, with regard to, for example, Matoska, I see that particular building outperformed what the estimates were. And then on the flip side, I see Birch Lake quite significantly underperformed. And I'm just wondering if those are considered anomalies or if adjustments should be made with regard to those buildings. In other words, is there any chance that Matoska more panels could be put up there? I don't know exactly how full that roof is. And on the flip side, if any angle adjustments or anything like that need to be made at Birch. So I guess that's one set of questions. The other is I noticed that Otter Lake and I believe Vadnais and perhaps the Hugo Elementary buildings are not either slated to have anything put on them or don't have anything either on them. And just wondering if there's going to be like a phase three for those buildings or if they're just not good candidates for solar at this point in time.
Yeah, Kim, I can answer the second part of that question. Otter Lake, Hugo, Vadnais, and ALC. ALC wasn't a good candidate. It just didn't get enough sunshine. We looked at that last year. But Hugo, Vadnais, and Otter, the ages of those roofs are just at that age where it would be really tough for us to put panels on just because we know the roofs are probably going to need to be replaced in the next 10 years. So that the expense of taking them off and putting them back on just didn't justify it at this time. But definitely, I think phase three would be a ways down the road. But I think it would definitely be our goal to put panels on all of our roofs. And then Chris, I know Kim asked about some panels that look to underperform a bit. Can you speak to that?
Yeah, I'm going to take a peek here. But generally speaking, what we're doing with every single solar array is we're looking at the conditions that are kind of at that location on Earth with that solar array pointing in directions as close to south as we can. All the solar panels are kind of set at a fixed 10-degree tilt. So short of them being placed in the physical environment that they're in, they're all designed basically to perform the same. What will happen is at one particular site, you might have a part that needed to be replaced during startup. So there might be a little bit of diminishment in production from that. The other thing is there might be a tree that shades one site versus another with a slight shadow at one particular point of the day. So when we see a little bit of variance from solar arrays, we don't get excited about it. What we do is we make sure that the solar arrays parts are performing and operational. So when we're using the equipment that we have, we're able to look at the individual parts all the way down to the individual solar panel and make sure everyone's operating. And then what will happen is some of the solar arrays will perform a little bit differently than the others. That's clouds and all sorts of different things. So you kind of need to look across them and roll it up and make sure that everything's making sense. So we have like 400 sites that we look at, and we see a variance of about 5%. They're up and down from relative to each other. But that's just kind of how solar tends to work. So we're always aiming to achieve results that are predictable over a 10-year period based upon that location and earth and weather patterns and the equipment that we're using. So there's going to be a little bit of variance site to site. The one that's down is because we had to deal with probably a physical problem that we dealt with, and now it's performing well. That's kind of solar. That's why we're there, to maintain the solar arrays for you and make sure they're always operating at their peak efficiency. On the backside of this, we have guarantees that say if we don't produce the amount of energy that we need to, that we pay you guys back. So we're very mindful of maximizing production that these solar arrays produce. So it's just kind of the way the sun lands and the ebb and flows of just managing solar products for you guys that create those little bit of variance from site to site.
You know, if I can just add one thing to that, Chris. Dan and I were geeking out a little bit on this last year. So we have an app on our phone where we can monitor the sites during the day to see if what kind of generation we're getting out of there. Mm-hmm. And Birch Lake, for whatever reason, became compacted with ice early in the winter last year and went for quite a long time before that ice melted. At the same time, we were watching Matoska, which didn't get entirely compacted. It had just a small area collecting, and that small area just kept collecting during those really icy cold days, where Birch was just a blackout for, I don't know if it was 5 or 6 weeks. And we don't want to send the custodians up there to chip away the ice and damage the panels, so we just let it melt. But Chris and his team factored that in, that there are times in Minnesota where they're going to be snow compacted.
Yeah, I actually called Chris and Rich and said something's wrong, and they actually sent somebody out to check it out and go up on the roof, and they sent me back photos of all the snow and ice compacted on the panels. So
that's the part of my brain I can't remember, Dan, but thank you for bringing it up. that's definitely kind of on point. I forgot about that. Thank you. So like when you have like winter conditions and snow, one site is going to be impacted by snow differently, because snow clears panels in the winter for the most part over time, as long as they're not completely deluged with a little bit of snow and wind. So if you have like a place which has a different wind pattern on top of the solar array, you're going to see different kind of conditions when you're exposed to snow. So I'm imagining that what you're saying, Dan, is that that's kind of a winter condition where you'll get a little bit of variance, but probably not the summer where you would expect the sun to shine evenly on everything.
Yeah, last year we just had sleet covered by snow, and that layer of frozen sleet never really melted.
Yeah.
For a long time anyway. So
that's why you send your data, because one year is going to be way up and the other year we'll have like a snow event and stuff. And that's kind of how solar works.
Great. Thank you for that explanation.
Pleasure.
So at this point, it's 7 o'clock. I think Mr. Wald, I think what we'll need to do, and want to, if there's additional questions, I think we need to go to our truth and taxation. So if you don't mind, we can just take a quick break from this and move back so that we can start our truth and taxation right at 7 o'clock, if that's okay.
Yep. Very good.
Thank you very much. So with that, we will back up. We will take a break from discussion item 4. We will back up to discussion item 1. This is the presentation and public hearing related to the proposed 2020 payable 2021 property tax levy. The public hearing will start at 7 p.m. White Bear Lake Area Schools, public forum and truth and taxation comments forum. With that, I will turn it over to Mr. Wald. I believe that you have a presentation, and then we will move into our public hearing and allow time for public comment. We would ask that anybody wishing to give public comment that you use the duration of 3 minutes in length. We will set a timer to make sure that we are able to do that. With that, I will turn it over to Mr. Walt, and we will start to move through the process.
All right. Thank you, Chair Mullen, members of the board, Dr. Kazmierczak and Ms. Adams. This is our public hearing for school district taxes payable in 2021. This is the final step in certifying the 2021 tax levy. Presentation is a bit lengthy. It's about 40 slides, so I'll try to move this along. The presentation is being posted on our website on the finance page for anyone who wants to dig into it a little more. It's under additional resources and presentations. So that'll be available there. There are statutory requirements for reporting at this meeting that will be fulfilled tonight. We've included a link on the agenda for tonight's meeting for the public to submit comments for the hearing. So please feel free to do so, and we'll read the comments at the end of the presentation. This presentation will include some background information on school funding, the district's budget, district's proposed tax levy for taxes payable in 2021, and again, opportunity for public comments. School funding is the responsibility of the state government. Article 13, Section 1 in the Minnesota Constitution requires the legislature to provide a general and uniform system of public schools, and will use funding methods, including taxation, to ensure a thorough and efficient system of public schools in Minnesota. So it is a constitutional requirement of our state. We have a highly regulated funding system, including the taxation system. So the state develops the formulas, mostly based on a per student basis. The state develops tax policy, minimum or maximum tax thresholds, and allows school boards to submit referendums for voter approvals, for operating and capital needs. There are some challenging themes related to school funding in Minnesota. First, problematic for school funding is that the state funding formula has not kept pace with inflation. During the past legislative session, there was an increase of 2% each year to the student formula. And note that that 2% did not apply to all of our funding, but just to the student formula. So given the pandemic and the impact on state funding, it's reasonable to believe that we will not see increases in the state formula over the next biennium, and that will signal a challenging time for school districts for sure. So even after a modest increase this past year, this 2%, the state would need to increase funding by another $503 per student, or 7.7%, to have kept pace with inflation since 2002-03. This graph shows that gap in funding over time. So beginning at in 2003, and you can visualize the widening gap between funding and inflation. So this has been an ongoing issue our state has struggled with over time. You can see periods of time when the gap widened, where the funding flattens and widens the gap, and we really never recover from that when there is flat funding, which makes us very concerned as we enter some difficult state funding with the next biennium. A second challenge for Minnesota schools is related to special ed funding. Neither the state nor the federal government have fulfilled their promises for funding special education mandates. In Minnesota, we see our special ed costs increasing significantly higher than the consumer price index. When special ed funding does not match expenses, it requires school districts to pay the remaining costs directly from the general fund. And this underfunding of special ed costs statewide equals $5,705 per special ed student. That's over $10 million in our district of unfunded mandate. $10 million that comes directly from our general fund. This underfunding requires a transfer of the general education dollars general education dollars to special ed, and we refer to that as the cross subsidy. The state's underfunding of the special education mandate, it's a significant contributor to the pressure on school districts to rely on local referendum to cover expenses. Most education associations have prioritized this at the legislative level, as it's an issue significantly impacting our schools. Did get some attention at the last legislative session, and so our legislators recognize that this is a challenge for our school districts and are looking to solve that. With these factors in mind, there's a growing dependence on local support for schools in the form of voter-approved referendum. If you go back to 92, 93, 65% of districts in Minnesota had operating revenue in place, and it came to $332 per student. Next year, 100% of school districts will have operating referendum or board-approved local operating revenue, accounting for 14.3% of the general fund operation or operating revenue statewide. So for decades now, there's been this shift to move education funding to the local tax levies. Change in levy does not determine the change in budget. And so that first box indicates the levy is based on a combination of state determined formulas in addition to voter approved referendums. And the second box refers to shifts from state aid to local levies. These moves increase school districts' levy revenue by an amount equal to the decrease in state aid, resulting in an increase in property taxes with no increase in school district revenue. In this case, it's just a shift in revenue from state aid to the local levy. And that doesn't happen all the time, but there's been a move in that, as you've seen, on the dependence on local referendum. There are state maximums for levy revenue, and our levy falls below those maximums. So ultimately, an increase in school taxes does not always correlate to an increase in revenue. The city, county, and school district levy cycles differ. The city and county budget years match their calendar year, while the school district year matches the school year. So revenue collected in 2021 will actually be used for the 21-22 school year. The budget will be adopted in June, so for the purposes of that hearing, tonight we'll look at the 2019-2020 budget. I mentioned earlier that school funding in Minnesota is a very complex system. So for the purposes of funding and reporting, school districts manage 9 separate funds. And we'll look at these in the following slides. We're required to publish a report of our budget and fund balances. This slide represents the report that was published in the White Bear Press in late November. And the next few slides provide a breakdown of revenues and expenditures that make up the numbers in this table. And there are 9 different funds on that table. Looking first at this pie chart details all of our revenue sources. A total of $162,245,972. And the majority of that revenue is within the general fund, about 75.5% as represented in blue on this pie chart. Now we'll look more closely at the general fund revenue to see the sources of the majority of our revenue. This pie chart shows the general fund revenue that accounts for 75.5% of our funding. We see that the majority of that money comes in the form of state aid, 71.5%. The next is local revenue in the blue pie at 26.1%. You can see that federal government aid accounts for a very small percentage of our budget, about 2.4%, and that's been a decreasing percentage over the years. Includes title funds, some nutrition services, and some special education revenue as well. And these are very typical numbers, percentages in the metro area. This slide breaks out our expenditures by object. You can see in the blue and the orange, combine those, that salaries and benefits constitute the majority of our expenditures, about 82%. So this is to be expected in a human resources heavy industry like education. Next is purchase services at about 10%. And that includes services programming at 916, like career and tech courses and special ed setting 4 tuition. Purchase services include fees to 916, as well as transportation, maintenance contractors, et cetera. Here we look at the general fund expenditures by program, and we can see regular ed accounts for 46.4 and special ed at 20.4. Those two funds account for for about 2/3 of our general fund expenditures. That's followed by pupil support, 10.8%. That's social workers, counselors, health services, transportation. Again, this is very typical from year to year, and it looks very much like most metro school districts. Moving on now, we'll look at how the levy is determined, look at this year's levy compared to last year. We'll look at reasons for the changes in the tax levy and impact on property taxes. A little bit about property taxes. Property owners pay taxes to multiple taxing jurisdictions, including county, their local municipality, school district, and special districts. Each jurisdiction sets their levy as allowed by statute. The county bills, collects and distributes the funds to the jurisdictions, including a school district. The county distributes those funds. So once the school board sets the levy, the county collects the appropriate taxes. Should be noted, this past year, there was an error at the county level impacting those in Anoka County. The error occurred between Ramsey County and Anoka County, resulting in an undertaxing of ISD 624 properties, excuse me, in Anoka County. So because of this, our Anoka County friends saw lower taxes last year than those in Washington County and Ramsey County, but they're seeing a more significant increase this year than those two counties. In each of those, residents received a letter explaining that. Each November, properties receive a report of the preliminary tax levy for the upcoming year that looks very much like this. We've already received these this year. It compares our proposed levy to the previous year, shows voter and non-voter approved taxes, reporting by each jurisdiction, and notice a public hearing as we're having tonight. Usually we would do this in person, of course, but most jurisdictions are virtual this year. A little bit about how school district taxes are computed. School districts can levy up to 40 different categories of taxes, and not all districts qualify for each of these categories. There are max limits for each levy category. An MDA, the Minnesota Department of Education, calculates a levy limit for each district. Most districts, ourselves included, don't levy always to the maximum levy or to the maximum amount. Now we'll take a look at the key steps in determining the district tax levy. Key steps in the process are summarized on this slide. Any of these steps may affect the taxes on a parcel of property, but the district has control only over one of the seven steps. The school board is involved in step six, but many factors come into play prior to this. So first, the county assesses the value of each parcel of property. Second, the legislature sets formulas for tax capacity, determines the percentage of levy burden for each type of property. Third, the county auditor collects the tax or calculates the tax capacity for each parcel and the net tax capacity for the entire district. The legislature, number four, sets the school district tax levy limits. Fifth, MDE calculates the levy limits for each district based on the legislature's work in step four. Sixth, the school board adopts a proposed levy in September and the final levy in December. And then finally, the auditor determines the final tax based on the value of each property against the district's total tax capacity. So that number six is the step that we are at here tonight, approving the final levy. This slide walks through the timeline of the seven steps. In early September, MD prepares a rough draft of the maximum levy amount. And then on September 28th, you approved the maximum. By late November, the county sent out the proposed preliminary statements to property owners. Tonight, we're holding our public hearing on the proposed levy. And then following the hearing tonight, the board will certify the final levy. The proposed tax levy for 2021 is an increase from 2020 of $1,093,289, or 1.96%. This includes a decrease of $220,655 from the proposed levy approved by the school board in September, because the district was able to refinance some existing bonds, taking advantage of lower interest rates, and that lowered our debt service payments. Reasons for major increases and decreases in levy are on the following slides. So this page provides a summary of our levy changes in the general fund, community services, and debt services. I won't go through each line, but I'll explain in the following slides the changes in each of these areas. In our voter-approved operating levy, we're seeing a decrease, reflecting a decrease in enrollment during the COVID-19 pandemic. Recall that our enrollment is down about 250 students, and that the impact of that on our operating levy is to drop it by almost $700,000. Again, this is an experience that districts across the state, well, across the nation, are experiencing right now as enrollment in our public schools dropped significantly this year. Initial figures for the levy are estimates based on enrollment and expenditure projections. I said this, funds collected are for the 21-22 school year, so we're projecting what that budget might be. As final enrollment and categorical spending is finalized, the Department of Education retroactively adjusts our levies based on actual enrollment and spending. It makes adjustments to the following year based on these changes. So every taxing jurisdiction makes these corrections for the previous year. This year, the prior year adjustment reduces the Pay 21 levy by $1.7 million. So essentially, this is a correction of last year's levy. Differences in long-term facilities maintenance, debt service, and a significant decrease in OPEB bond debt service balance out the remaining levy change. The increases to debt service from the 2019 facilities bond and LTFM are somewhat offset by the decrease in debt service for the OPEB bonds. So recall that the OPEB bonds are for other post-employment benefits, essentially benefits other than pensions. So those bonds are now paid off, and so we see the debt service reduction in that area. There are multiple factors that impact property taxes. Certainly the district levy can impact property tax changes from year to year, but that's just part of it. So when property owners see an increase in the assessed value of their property relative to other properties in the taxing jurisdiction, it results in them paying a larger share of the taxes collected. Likewise, if one's property value increases less than the average, they would see a decrease in their property taxes. Next, we'll look at the trend in property taxes over the past 4 years. So the following graphs will show the impact of school district taxes on property since 2018. And that's based on an average 14.1% increase in property values. An individual may be impacted more or less during this time of property value, depending on the property value changes on their individual parcel. So these tables show the average. Excuse me, they show the average. They may look different for individuals.
Dr. Kazmierczak, is Mr. Wald okay?
I suspect he, there he goes. I think he hit a button. Mr. Wald, are you back on?
Mr. Wald, you're muted.
Sorry, I was muting my microphone for a moment and I must have logged out by accident. So a dramatic exit there. We'll try not to do that again. Okay, so again, we're back to just looking at the four-year trend on property taxes. And again, these are based on City of White Bear taxes and these are just preliminary estimates. So we look at this page. We can go ahead. There we go. This chart shows property taxes from 2018 to 2021. Again, home values increased by 14.1%. And the second to last column indicates the change over 4 years. And the final column indicates the change in 2021. So on taxes payable 2020, the referendum, facilities referendum, bumped those up a bit. And then this year, you'll actually see in every home value of $600,000 or less, you see an actual decrease in property values or property taxes for pay 21. Same data in graph form. And again, you can see when the referendum passed, that bumped up 2020 and an actual slight decline in property, school district property taxes for 2021. Here it is looking at commercial property. The first chart was residential property, and the second chart is commercial property. Well, can you go ahead, Steve, to the, okay. The state of Minnesota has a few refund programs and a tax deferral program available. We don't give tax advice, but you can take a look at revenue.state.mn.us. The homestead credit refund, also known as the circuit breaker refund, has been around for almost 50 years to owners of homestead properties. And this is something qualifying homeowners can apply for. It's renewable each year. It does have an income limit of $115,000, which often works for individuals or those on fixed incomes. And this is also available to renters. Renters can talk to their landlords about that. A second program to support taxpayers is the Minnesota Special Property Tax Refund. This is available if an increase is 12% or more and more than $100. It's especially helpful after a referendum, but the refund is 60% of the increase greater than 12% up to a maximum of $1,000. You can find more information on the state website. And then finally, for those over age 65 and a maximum $60,000 income, they can defer a portion of their taxes, limiting property taxes to no more than 3% of one's income. It's important to note that this is deferred, it's not forgiven. So this program allows seniors predictability on what their property taxes will be and allows them to ride what might be significant changes perhaps in any given year. Again, the taxes are deferred and it's settled when the home is sold. And so that ends our presentation for the tax hearing. The board will be asked to vote and certify the levy as an action item this evening. The final action tonight here for this presentation is to read any public comments that may have come in. And Ms. Vetti, I believe, is monitoring that.
I am monitoring it, and there haven't been any comments that have come in.
Okay, before we go to the action item, we can check that one more time if people are just furiously typing away right now. So that is our truth and taxation hearing for taxes payable for 2021.
Thank you very much, Mr. Wald.
I'll add one thing. We had one visitor stop by District Center, and I was able to spend a few minutes with them and address this question.
Okay, thank you.
Can I ask one question?
Sure.
As you go back to those nice charts, and you said clearly that one of the pie charts showed regular ed funding was 46%, special ed was 22% approximately, and then pupil support was 10.8, if I recall. I wrote that down. And you listed a few things, but I'm thinking as we look at our students and add to the kinds of supports they need, whether it's more things for social emotional or more cultural liaisons, things like that, are we stuck with that percent, or do we up the percent of student support, and then just are we allowed to move, I guess, percentages? Or are those set by the state, or are those percentages set by our budget?
No, that's a great question, Dr. Newmaster. So that's on the expenditures pie chart. Okay, I think Steve's got it up here. And so that shows pupil support services at 10.6% of our expenditures. So we have control over expenditures. So if we were to decide to move some funding out of any other of these other categories, we can move it in, that in percentage would go up then, and we drop in a different area.
Okay, so I'm looking at when we see a student need, whether it's more social workers or counselors or library media specialists, then where does that come from? Some other budget?
Well, no. It's a pie chart. So if you're going to add more to one category, you're going to decrease it somewhere else. And so we would, if we added more social workers, let's say, we would add, we would code those as pupil support services. It would increase that expenditure budget, and the revenue for that, would mostly come out of general fund.
Okay, so if we do changes, changing one thing has to be bumped up by something else, and any student support, we have decided what percent of our budget goes to that. It's not set.
That is correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Newmaster. Are there any other questions regarding Mr. Wald's report? Okay.
Oh,
go ahead, Ms. Ellison.
Oh, sorry, Chair Mullen. I just wanted to thank Mr. Wald and his team. This is a lot of numbers and a lot of ducks to keep in a row with all the different pots of money and taxes. So I just appreciate this presentation and all the work that went into it. So thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Kazmierczak, is there anybody else that has come in the last couple seconds of us? I just want to make sure that if there's anybody there that wants to provide public comment, that they have the ability to.
No, there's nobody here, and the gentleman who stopped by did not want to make a public comment. He just had some questions that we were able to address.
Okay.
By myself.
Okay, with that, we will close the public hearing, and we will move on to, we will revert back to our discussion item. Thank you, Mr. Wald, for your work. And we'll move back to our D4 and answer and ask, is there any other questions regarding the Guarantee Energy Savings Agreement under D4? Okay. Hearing and seeing none, we will move on to our next discussion item, D5, which is the 2019-2020 World's Best Workforce Summary. And I believe that is Dr. Gillespie.
It is. Thank you, Chair Mullen, members of the board, Dr. Kazmierczak. We spoke in length and in depth at our last work study session around our 2019-2020 update around our world's best workforce goals and achievement and integration goals. We had some reporting challenges moving to distance learning due to the COVID-19 and the pandemic. And so I will give a summary of what we discussed. And then our this report has been on our website and will continue to be there. And then I will submit this annual update to the Minnesota Department of Education as is required yearly. So Steve, you can go to the next slide. So World's Best Workforce, we have 5 goal areas. All children are ready for school. All third graders can read at grade level. All racial and economic achievement gaps between students are closed. All students are ready for career in college, and all students graduate from high school. As we look at our first goal area, all students graduating, we had a goal of increasing our graduation rate to 89.4%. We surpassed that goal, and our graduation rate for the class of 2019 is 91.2%. While we're happy with meeting our goal, we continue to strive to ensure that each one of our students graduates, and we do have gaps in terms of racial gaps and students who qualify for free and reduced lunch and our special education and ELL students. And so as we continue to look at closing those gaps, we've implemented the BAR program at our high school, and Ange Nelson and Joe Held will be here in a couple months to update you on that program, where we focus on 9th graders and how we can enhance that experience so that we increase graduation rate and help them with their success in high school. And then we're deeply examining equitable grading practices, have been engaged in that practice for quite some time now, and are currently doing a lot of work around that as we navigate distance learning and the learning models this current school year. The next goal is all students are college and career ready. Our goal that we had set prior was really looking at the percentage of students who need developmental coursework, and we set a goal to reduce that to 15%. We didn't quite reach that goal. This data is challenging to gather. We use a website, SLEDS it's called, and it tracks data in Minnesota. It's not comprehensive in terms of where our students may enroll outside of school, outside of Minnesota, excuse me. And while we absolutely want to impact this, because this is an expense that our students incur and they don't usually count towards any major of study, we believe that we can look at data that will be closer to our students' experience and data that we can more quickly influence. And so we will work with our World's Best Workforce Advisory Committee and then our Teaching and Learning Department to really examine how we define college and career ready and bring some recommendations to the board within the next few board meetings. Our goal around all racial and economic achievement gaps between students are closed. We've done significant work on making sure that our students who enroll in our college credit-bearing classes, College in the Schools, ECIS, Project Lead the Way, in our AP courses is reflective of our demographics in our schools. We've made a lot of headway. We still have work to do around to be completely representative of our student groups. However, we also have increased this year for our goal to also look at student success in those classes. And while we do see that students are having success, we want to make sure that that classroom experience is supportive and something that students are really enjoying and teachers feel well equipped to support students who maybe haven't been taking these classes. So we've extended the goal to also look at students enrolling, but also what grade they're earning in those classes. Unfortunately, our data around all children are ready for school, we're unable to report because of tracking data internally and the challenges with testing. We are continuing to have some really robust conversations around what this looks like, and we're excited about aligning our assessment system to be able to report this and really look at how our students in our preschool programs entering kindergarten and what does that data say. But due to COVID-19, we weren't able to collect that data. And the final goal is all third graders can read at grade level. Again, we're doing a lot of work around making sure that our students are continuing to receive support. And we have internal assessments and progress monitoring that we're navigating, but we're unable to report the end result because we did not administer the Minnesota Comprehensive Assessments last year due to the pandemic. And so we're really excited about the work that we're engaging in and working hard to align our assessments so that if we aren't able to administer the MCAs this year, which right now the plan is that we would administer them, that we would be able to give you data on our screening and progress monitoring and the progress that our students have been able to make. Additionally, as part of World's Best Workforce, we focus on equitable access to effective teachers, and my colleague Matt Mons is going to briefly talk about our efforts in this area.
So there we're really looking at a couple of different things. One is access to highly effective teachers, and that's an area where I'm pleased to report we really don't have a gap. So between our schools, we see a consistent level of access to those teachers. Where we do tend to see that there might be a gap there, it really tends to come when we're looking at highly specialized programming for which there aren't very many licensed teachers on the market, frankly. So those tend to be the areas where we might have less of that. So we're generally trying to hire somebody that has a strong skill set within a content area, but they may not have as much experience in a traditional teaching setting. So when we're thinking about that, you can think about some of our trade skills kinds of offerings. And you can look at FACS, for instance, and some of our other specialized programming. That's where you would generally find that gap, but that doesn't track with our diverse student populations. We feel good about the trends that we do see there. It's also looking at recruitment and retention. We spoke to this a little bit last month, actually, and we saw that despite some difficulties in our attempts to recruit versus how we would generally try to do that, we were able to stay at least even with where we were the year before, and we did make some slight gains in terms of matching our staff to our student body demographics. However, we still have a long way to go for that being truly representative of our student body. So, you know, that's something that we take very seriously, but we were happy to see that we didn't lose ground in that endeavor as we move forward. So that's really what World's Best Workforce is looking at there. You know, when it comes to retention, we've been working hard too, just to considering some different opportunities that we might have to engage in to make sure that we're really accomplishing two goals, one of which is to make sure that there's ready access so that our staff members, our diverse staff members, have easy access to share their perspectives and voice with leadership in the district. And so that's something we're taking very seriously. And then just making sure too that we're creating a sense of community for our staff members that may need that. And so that's really our push as we're moving forward here in order to you know, to attempt to retain all of our highly qualified, diverse staff members.
Thank you, Mr. Mons. And finally, our achievement and integration plan. The 2019-20 closes out a three-year plan, and we have a refined plan that started this school year and will go 3 years. And so goals corresponded to the World's Best Workforce goal. The graduation rate was a little bit higher than our goal, so we didn't meet that goal. If you remember, we did meet the World's Best Workforce goal, but didn't meet that in terms of our achievement and integration. We also had a goal that was around closing achievement gaps in both math and reading, and unfortunately we're unable to report that because it was based in the Minnesota Comprehensive Assessment, the MCAs. Additionally, we have one racially identifiable school as determined by the Minnesota Department of Education, and Willow Lane Elementary, and Willow had two goals last year. Both were impacted in terms of reporting, but they continue to do significant work internally on making sure of increasing student reading proficiency. Their goal was based in the MCAs, and again, we didn't administer those tests. And then really looking at integration learning experiences with Otter Lake, students had participated at Tamarack Learning Center, and they were excited about a plan, and that was interrupted due to distance learning. I'm excited to report there's some pretty creative planning going on right now, so we don't see those same interruptions. So that completes my summary report. I don't know if there's any additional questions for me.
Thank you, Dr. Gillespie. I know that we had had that we had discussed this in the work study session. I see a hand raised from Dr. Arcan.
Yes, thank you. I just had a quick question. As we're hiring these industry experts on a Tier 1 license, are we providing additional supports to assist them on their journey, to their educational journey, up to the Tier 4? Or how are we helping them along?
Yeah, so I can handle some of that, and then I don't know, Dr. Gillespie, if you'd like to add on. But yes, we absolutely do. So we make sure that there's a plan right away where we're addressing what those individual needs are. And, you know, that works best at the site level, of course. But then there's also a plan for, you know, what is that teacher going to be doing in terms of enhancing their own professional practice, in terms of education for themselves as well. But another thing that I'd really like to mention there is, even though, yes, we are looking for a content-specific skill set, it's also extremely important, and frankly more important, that the individuals we're hiring are going to be highly effective teachers that build great relationships with kids. And so, you know, we'll pass if the only thing, you know, if we're concerned that this might just be about a skill set as opposed to the ability to really form those relationships and move the needle for kids. And so I just want to make sure that that's really clear too. Whenever we're looking to bring folks in that might come from a non-traditional background, we do view it as absolutely essential that they're here for the right reason, that they want to see kids grow, and that they're going to be effective in that endeavor.
And I agree, and I totally support that. I just want to make sure that we're taking those great teachers that are developing great teachers, and we're providing the supports they need so they continue to grow, and we keep them.
That would absolutely be my
thought. Absolutely. Yep. And teaching and learning, we partner with the building principals and with the educator to really develop a personalized support plan, because often there's a lot of certification and extra, you know, professional development that needs to happen. And so how can we come alongside that educator and help them? So as we all remember, the first year and couple years of teaching is quite overwhelming. And so how can we help them feel successful and really partner together? And we learn a lot also with great perspectives from people outside of the field, but we want to make sure that they're equipped with what they need. So thank you.
Thank you, Chair Mullen. I yield the floor back.
Thank you, Dr. Arcan. Are there other questions, comments? Dr. Newmaster.
I just have one. I've been meeting with early childhood PTA for this is now the fifth or sixth year as a liaison. And all of the pieces that you're keeping track of are so complicated. One of them I didn't even think about until I heard the early educators talk about it is we're down in kindergarten screening because of COVID and all the issues, but some of it's just the expenses of having the extra audiometer to do the hearing test. That's like almost $1,000 a piece, and it has to be wiped down, and many times they're going to where the kids are that aren't coming in for appointments, whether it's a housing situation or whatever. So I'm just thinking of all the extra expenses and complications with COVID. One of them is just getting those kids screened so they can come to kindergarten. So if we're looking at preschool, kindergarten ready, just the screening is more complex than I would have ever thought about it. So I know we're looking at a GoFundMe with a matching thing to try and get another set so that more screeners can go out, because there's kindergartners potentially out there and we just don't have the portable gear to do the screening right now. So that just blew my mind that we just don't have enough. It's not like you can have them all in a room and move them through stations. So lots more expenses, but lots of people thinking hard on how to get around it. So anyway, that's my comment, but we'll send you all a copy of the GoFundMe.
Thank you, Dr. Newmaster. Are there other questions, comments, concerns? All right, Dr. Gillespie, do you have anything to finish?
No, thank you so much.
Thank you very much. We will now move to our next discussion, item D6, which is the first reading of some school board policies. Just for the general public's knowledge, as our policies work, they occasionally go up for updating, and then they come before the board in two consecutive months for a first reading, allowing board members to respond to them. And then a second reading. So this month, coming in for our first reading, our policy is 419, tobacco-free environment, policy 430, employee visitors ID badges, policy 517, student recruiting, policy 518, DNR, DNI orders, and policy 607, organization of grade levels. With that, are there any comments or concerns regarding those policies? Hearing or seeing none.
I have one in regards to the packet. If you bear with me 1 second, it's in regards to the tobacco and vaping policy
419.
Yes, and it's in section 4A.
4A. So if you can just give everybody a quick second to get there. 4. Okay.
Oh, am I in the right? Yes. Okay. So I just want to make sure that we're using the appropriate wording in this portion of the policy in regards to the American Indian. Have we asked our cultural liaison, Ms. Zickerman, if that would be the appropriate way to address Native Americans? I just want to make sure that we're using the proper wording there, and then it doesn't follow through the rest of that part of the policy. It just says American Indian in the first part, and then the American doesn't follow the rest of them. And I'm not sure if American Indian is necessarily the appropriate way to address that. I just want to make sure that we've asked our cultural liaison about that verbiage that we chose.
We can certainly, review that before we bring it back for a second read and make sure that it's both consistent and that we feel like it's, you know, the best way of addressing that group.
Great. That was my only question or comment. So thank you. I'd appreciate that.
Thank you, Ms. Thompson. Are there any other comments, questions, concerns regarding the first reading of said policies? Hearing or seeing none, we will move into our first operational item, E1, which is action on the certification of the 2020 payable 2021 property tax levy. Mr. Wald.
Okay. Thank you, Chair Mullen, members of the board. Earlier this evening, we held our Truth in Taxation hearing where we reviewed the district's budget, the proposed change in property tax levy, and the reasons for the change. The increase for Pay 21 tax levy is 1.96%, totaling $59,987,674.46, which is lower than what was initially proposed in September by a number of $220,654.68, due to the savings from bond refunding in October. We're recommending the board move to approve the certification of the final 2020 payable tax levy in the amount of $56,987,674.46.
Thank you, Mr. Wald. You've heard the recommended action. Is there a motion to do so?
So moved.
A motion by Dr. Newmaster. Is there a second?
Second.
Second Ellison. By Ms. Ellison. Is there any discussion regarding the recommended action? Mr. Chapman.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm just getting ready to vote.
Okay. Is there any discussion regarding the recommended action? Hearing or seeing none, this will require a roll call vote. Would ask the clerk to please reflect the roll.
Chapman?
Aye.
Ellison? Aye. Mullen?
Aye.
Newmaster?
Aye.
Thompson?
Aye.
Arcand?
Aye.
Beloid?
Aye.
And the motion passes. Thank you all very much. We will now move to our second operational item, E2, which is the action on the guaranteed energy savings agreement. Mr. Wald.
Okay, just have to unmute. Okay. Earlier this evening, we had a discussion item regarding phase two installation of solar panels at sites across the district. This includes installation of roof-mounted solar panels at Lincoln Elementary, Central Middle School, North Campus High School Addition, South Campus, the new transportation facilities facility, and the new elementary school in Hugo. We're recommending the board approve the guaranteed energy savings contract with Ideal Energies, LLC, and Green 2 Solar Leasing for installing the second phase solar projects.
Thank you, Mr. Wald. You've heard the recommended action. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Motion by Ms. Thompson. Is there a second?
Second, Newmaster.
A second by Dr. Newmaster. Is there any discussion regarding the recommended action? Hearing or seeing none, this will require a roll call vote. Would ask the clerk to please read the roll.
Chapman?
Aye.
Ellison? Aye. Mullen?
Aye.
Newmaster?
Aye.
Thompson?
Aye.
Arcand?
Aye.
Beloid?
Aye.
And the motion passes. Thank you all very much. We'll now move into our third operational item, E3, which is action on the acceptance of the Brocious grants. Dr. Kazmierczak.
All right, thank you, Chair Mullen. So the White Bear Lake Area Educational Foundation has forwarded 6 brochures teaching grants to me with the request that these grants be formally accepted by the school board. As part of the internal process, prior to consideration of any proposal, the foundation reviews the proposals with our administration, and we confirm the proposals are consistent with our curriculum and if technology is used consistent with our technology plan. There are 6 grants. I'll just read the title of them along with the staff members who submitted. So increasing communication, play, and social skills through play, Otter Lake Elementary, Teresa Stender, Sunrise Skaters, Sunrise Park Middle School, Mark Misgan, Julie Nasvik, and Keith Lockwood, connecting family literacy families with classroom areas of study at Normandy Park, Ann Zettel, intermediate word study project, Lake Ayers Elementary, Sandra Whitby, near or far, group is where you are, improving connections between hybrid and distance learners through technology. That's the ALC and the Insight program, Tracy Baumaster and Beth Samuelson, and then Bears Protecting Bears, South Campus, and that was submitted by Lindsay Lammers. So recommended action is to accept the 6 brochures teaching grants from the White Bear Lake Area Educational Foundation as shown in the attached in your board materials in the total amount of $8,471.95.
Thank you, Dr. Kazmierczak. You've heard the recommended action. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
A motion by Mr. Chapman. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Dr. Arcan. Any discussion regarding the recommended action? Hearing or seeing none, this will require a roll call vote. Would ask the clerk to please read the roll.
Chapman?
Aye.
Ellison? Aye. Mullen?
Aye.
Newmaster?
Aye.
Thompson?
Aye.
Arcand?
Aye.
Beloid?
Aye.
Thank you all very much, and the motion is approved. We will now move into our next operational item, E4, which is the action on the approval of the 2021 election polling place locations. Mr. Maurer.
Thank you, Chair Mullen. Good evening, everybody. Tonight, as per Minnesota statute, we do have an annual resolution before you to approve our polling places for the 2021 election polling sites, and we ask that you approve the resolution.
Thank you very much, Mr. Maurer. You've heard the recommended action. Is there a motion to do so?
So moved.
A motion by Ms. Thompson. Is there a second?
Second, Ellison.
Second by Ms. Ellison. Thank you. Is there any discussion regarding the recommended action? Hearing or seeing none, this will require a roll call vote. I would ask the clerk to please read the roll.
Chapman?
Aye.
Ellison? Aye. Mullen?
Aye.
Newmaster?
Aye.
Thompson?
Aye.
Arcand?
Aye.
Beloid?
Aye.
All right. Motion is passed. Thank you very much. We'll now move into our next operational item, E5, which is the action on the approval of the additional funds to the MDE Expanded Meal Access Grant and the Ramsey County Emergency Food Services Grant. Before we continue with this, Mr. Wald, I believe this is through the Ramsey County CARES Act, if I'm correct. And if so, I just want to say that I will be abstaining from the vote. I don't believe that there's a conflict of interest, but I just wanted to make sure because I sit on the Food and Basic Needs Committee at the Ramsey County. So I want to make sure that we don't generate any conflict of interest. With that, I will turn it over to Mr. Wald and we will continue with the discussion.
Okay, thank you, Chair Mullen. Our Nutrition Services Department has secured 2 additional grants for the board to approve. The first one is the Expanded Meal Access for MDE Minnesota Children and Adults Grant. That's a $20,000 grant. And that will be used for supplies for our meal drop sites. Our staff is distributing meals on some pretty cold days and some possibly some kind of wicked weather. And so we want to make sure that they're protected out there, that they're opportunity to stay warm, and that we have the right equipment to be able to distribute food. We also have, if you recall, I believe it was October, we approved a similar grant from the same organization for a new truck. And so that's going to allow us to deliver meals effectively. And that truck's going to be have a wrap on it with a White Bear Lake School District graphic on it that will bring lots of attention to it. So that $20,000 grant. And then the second grant is funding from Emergency Food Services, Meals for Youth and Children grant through Ramsey County. That grant totals $376,572.58. And there's many, many things that will cover, including packaging materials, storage equipment for food, equipment for, again, for serving the food at each site, as well as a significant amount of fresh produce and meals. So we'll be able to expand the amount of fresh food that we're serving in our meals. And we've had lots of families taking advantage of those free meals. And kudos to our nutrition services staff for doing an outstanding job of preparing all of that. And now they're preparing for 3 weeks of drops at one time. So there's going to be a significant amount of work on their plates this week. So thank you to our nutrition services staff. So their grants received this fall total about $500,000.
Is there a recommended action, Mr. Wall?
Yes. So the recommended action is to approve the $20,000 MDE Minnesota Children and Adults grant and the grant from Meals for Youth and Children grant through Ramsey County, totaling $376,572.58.
Thank you very much. You've heard the recommended action. Is there a motion to do so?
So moved, Newmaster, with gratitude.
Thank you very much, Dr. Newmaster. Is there a second?
Yeah, second that with equal amount of gratitude.
Thank you, Ms. Thompson. With that, is there any discussion regarding the grants?
Mr. Chair, I've got a question.
Mr. Chapman.
Yes, Mr. Wald, you had mentioned $20,000 in looking at the board packet for item number one. It's got $34,893.71. I was curious in terms of clarification of what the amount is. I assume it's the $34,900.
Yeah, oh boy, thank you for catching that. Yes, there was a last minute addition to that grant that she was able to access additional funds. So thank you for catching that. And that is the total that should be approved.
Great, thank you.
I would ask the record to reflect the correction. Thank you, Mr. Chapman. Is there any other questions or comments regarding the approved action? Hearing or seeing none, this will require a roll call vote. Would ask the clerk to please read the roll.
Chapman?
Aye.
Ellison? Aye. Mullen?
I abstain.
Newmaster?
Aye.
Thompson?
Aye.
Arcand?
Aye.
Beloid?
Aye.
Thank you all very much. The motion passes. We will now move into our next agenda item, if you'll excuse me. So the next one has several school board policies come before us for our next for our second reading. So with an okay, I'm going to read the policy numbers and I will go down the list of all of them and we can move through them. We'll take them in one fell swoop. Policy 421, policy 422, policy 510, policy 513, policy 515, policy 516, policy 601, policy 602, policy 603, policy 615, policy 620, policy 703, policy 904, and policy 598. Wow. With that, is there a motion to approve all of those policies? No motion.
So moved. Chair Mullen, the final policy is an elimination. Do we need to say approve all of the policies and then eliminate 598?
I thank you very much for that correction. I will would ask the record to reflect that we are eliminating policy 598 and that we are approving the other policies. Thank you, Ms. Ellison.
So moved.
And I thank you for your motion. Is there a second on that motion?
Second.
I'll take the second from Mr. Chapman. I think he came in a couple seconds before. We've got a motion and a second. Is there any discussion regarding the recommended action? Hearing or seeing none, this will require a roll call vote.
Chapman?
Aye.
Ellison? Aye. Mullen?
Aye.
Newmaster?
Aye.
Thompson?
Aye.
Arcand?
Aye.
Beloid?
Aye.
All right. And our last agenda item for this evening is number 7, E7, which is the action on the reduction of staff in the fee-based programs. Is this Mr. Wald?
No, this will be
Mr. Mons.
Mr. Mons, yes.
I apologize. Thank you.
So this evening, we do have a recommendation. We have made some staffing changes at this point already. Because we found ourselves in a position where our staffing levels no longer reflected the level of programming or service that we were offering. So with our transition in learning models, we've seen that, you know, we've got a different kind of work in nutrition services, and we were overstaffed in that area. We're certainly hoping that that's a short-term reduction in staffing there, and that we're able to get those employees back in action and be providing our previous level of meal service as quickly as possible. That does affect 14 employees there. And then similarly, in our early childhood programming, specifically in our preschool offerings, we've seen a relatively significant reduction in interest as we've moved between models here. And so again, we're looking at a reduction that would impact two staff members there that we're certainly hoping will be temporary in nature. So we've made those shifts and now are recommending board approval of those actions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mons. You've heard the recommended action. Is there a motion to approve the recommended action?
So moved.
Thank you, Ms. Ellison. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Beloid. Is there any discussion regarding the recommended action? Hearing or seeing none, this will require a roll call vote.
Chapman?
Clerk, to please.
Oh, sorry.
No, I apologize. You go ahead.
Chapman?
Aye.
Ellison? Aye. Mullen?
Aye.
Newmaster?
Marge, you're on mute.
Newmaster?
Sorry. Aye.
Thompson?
Aye.
Arcand?
Aye.
Beloid?
Aye.
All right. And the motion passes. Thank you all very much. It is the now time of the meeting open for board forum. I would add that would open the floor to any board members who wish to address on anything, not just tonight's agenda, but anything at all. Is there any board members that would like to add anything during board forum? Mr. Chapman?
I believe Ms. Ellison actually had her hand raised.
Go ahead, Mr. Chapman.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Ellison. I just want to wish everybody a very excellent, safe, happy, healthy holiday season. And I particularly want to also just reach out and express my gratitude to Jody, who has been just a trooper over the years, provided so much work and so much support to the administration and to the board. And I wish her the best of everything in her future, and enjoy that vacation, Jody, that you've got coming up that you've so well deserved. So take care, Jody.
Thank you, Mr. Chapman. And I apologize. I'd only get to see about three or four screens on the thing, so I apologize if I didn't catch Ms. Ellison. Ms. Ellison, do you have a comment?
Yes, thank you. Two things. One, I wanted to say that the work for the Equity Action Plan team has begun with Equity Alliance, and Ms. Thompson and I both are serving on that team, and the work is going to be it's already good, but I think with the equity audit that we had and was presented to us this summer and the team that we have in place, I'm really excited about this work that's continuing over the next couple of months. And the other thing I wanted to comment on is that I sort of have a microcosm of the coronavirus world in my house, you know, down to one income with a layoff and a working parent and four kids in the house. And I would just want to express my deep gratitude for everything that the district has done to support our parents and children and families. We do take advantage of the meals, and it has been a huge relief for us and I think for a lot of families. So I'm grateful. I'm grateful for the work of the teachers, the staff. I have a child with an IEP, and I am so pleased to be in this district. So thank you. Thank you to everyone.
Thank you, Ms. Ellison. Dr. Arcan, did you have a comment?
Oh, you're muted, Dr. Arcan.
It's got to come off. There it is. I hit it twice. Thank you. I just wanted to take this opportunity to just let you know I've been working from home, and I've had an office buddy, and I want to give a shout out to Cameron. He's allowed me to be in the room while he was attending Mrs. Hickman's kindergarten class, and it has allowed me to see the frustrations, the hard work, and everything that goes on. And so I want to make a personal thank you to Mrs. Hickman and all the work that her and all the teachers at Hugo Elementary were doing for that kindergarten class. It also allowed me to see the work that the parents and sometimes grandparents and daycare providers are putting in to work with these kids. It really opened my eyes, and it allowed me to play a lot of fun games. I'm learning to do my addition and subtraction, and it's been a great pleasure to have my little office buddy in here working with. It's been a long time since I've been in kindergarten or worked with a kindergartner. It was great. And anytime, call me. I will, when this is over, kindergarten classes, call me. I will come read, because it was wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Arcan. Are there anything else under board forum?
I had a comment.
Ms. Thompson.
First, I wanted to also say thank you to Jody for all of her work for our district for all these years. It has been a pleasure. Even though I've only gotten to really know you during this COVID environment we've been in, your help has been very much appreciated, and I just wanted to let you know that. And then I just had a feeling of being very blessed tonight with all of our wonderful community, the donation list that was added to our packet that everybody doesn't get to see because they're just in our informal part of the meeting, was extensive and is always very much appreciated. And then to see all of the great grants and all the other work that our administration and our educators are out there seeking and that we are given is something to be thankful for this time of year, especially as Ms. Ellison said, we know that there are a lot of people out there who life is different. I am also in that camp where I have a spouse who has lost his job due to COVID. Thankfully, things are working out for us currently, and hopefully, you know, we have things to look forward in the year to come. And then I had one other thing, but now I was also going to just bring up the Equity Alliance work that has started. And it, as Ms. Ellison said, it's very exciting, and I'm happy to be a part of the team and can't wait to get back onto the meeting this Friday to continue our work. So that was it. Thank you, everybody. I hope everyone has a happy holidays.
Thank you, Ms. Thompson. Dr. Newmaster.
And I would just like to add one more thing, all of the programs and the donations that help with our many members in our community. And I've heard what's going on in the senior group to preschool, and there's a lot of food insecure people, and we have a number of good programs that I'm glad to see are being supported. The seniors program that they did a shout out over the phones today, and the collaboration with the community partners like NewTrax, and it's just a really good community. White Bear Lake area schools, communities have worked together as best they can. And so I'd say thank you to everyone. It's truly in the season of thankfulness and looking forward to a good new year. So I wish you guys all a good holiday. And thank you, Jody. You made life much easier and more comprehensible to many of us. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Professor. Is there anybody else under board forum?
I had one more thing I forgot to mention. Our great theater department has sent out the links for the Songs of the New World performance that happened this fall. And while we weren't all there, able to be there to see it in person, and they're always so wonderfully put together, and it's just always something that I really enjoy doing. There are opportunities for us to stream those online, which also helps provide funding to that department. So just a little addition, something to look forward to. They have a one scheduled stream on December 18th at 7:30 p.m. And then they have a video on demand rental that starts on December 19th. I think what a great thing to do to help support our district and our theater department, because I can't wait till we can all get back together and watch them in person, hopefully next fall.
Thank you, Ms. Thompson. If there is nothing else, I will echo all the sentiments of all my colleagues. I wish everybody a happy holidays and a graceful exit to 2020. I am very happy that we'll be putting 2020 in the rearview mirror. And with that, I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
Chair Mullen, I motion for an adjournment.
I will second that and would ask the clerk to please call the roll.
Chapman?
Aye.
Ellison? Aye. Mullen?
Aye.
Newmaster?
Aye.
Thompson?
Aye.
Hand?
Aye.
Beloid?
Aye.
With that, we are adjourned. Have a good evening, everyone.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everyone. Have a great holidays.
Good night, everyone.
Good night. Happy New Year. It's coming.